topic of today, what should be allowed to call itself Debian? There is more and more pre-made images and similar things by various companies who obviously have a strong interest in their cloud product or whatever being called Debian for marketing reasons, and we also have an interest in having useful things called Debian. On the other hand, if there is too many changes, things or expectations might break. So there should be a common baseline, a rule set, guidelines, call it what you want, which tell people what they can expect if a certain name is attached to a certain product or image or what have you. There may also be different gradations of this is Debian, this is based on Debian, this is Debian by X. There are several possibilities which are floating around. So that's basically the topic for this talk. Does anyone want to start, or?
We discussed it a little bit yesterday, and so one thing that I'm curious about is that one of the really big hallmarks of Debian as a brand, I think, is that we have our stable releases, and they are really, really stable. Right? We've tested everything, we've uninstalled, we've upgraded, we've done everything you can do. And I would think that for something to be allowed to call itself Debian, it needs to have gone through the same level of testing. So right now, for example, you always install first the core system, right? And then after you've installed the core system, you run the installer or a pre-seed script or something like that, which gives you the next stage, and then you can install packages. And that has been tested really, really aggressively. If you do things in a different order, we don't actually know anything about whether it works or not. So I think we should think about that. Think about, do we want to be the recipients of bug reports and the people responsible for that system being stable when it's done in a different way that we don't actually understand necessarily? So maybe the answer is to get processes into the Debian project for how to build systems in different ways so we can test it, so we can know that it works. So we can know that for some packages, you can install them in a non-standard way and for others you can't.
So if those cloud providers build images based on Debian stable and just use everything which is in Debian stable, we are fine to call that Debian? Do we agree on that?
Not if it's today, I wouldn't say you are. Today, the real first handle at the Google at the Amazon images yesterday. The Google images very carefully say this is not an official Debian, this is modified.
Yeah, but if those images are not modified, if everything comes from Debian stable.
Well, if it's installed in a non-standard order, it might not work.
What is bootstrap? Step bootstrap? If it's just step bootstrap and then made an image of that?
It's very easy with step bootstrap to make a system that's broken. Even using only standard packages.
Okay.
What I see a problem with is the Amazon image, which is made with everything that is in Debian, but it needs the Amazon infrastructure to be built. And that bothers me, because obviously the Amazon infrastructure is non-free. And then we create, James is creating an image which is made of free software, but built with something that we don't control, and that is software as a service, so completely non-free. And then shall we call that Debian? I'm not sure. In fact, I don't like it, and it's my opinion that we shouldn't call it Debian. Is there anyone that shares that opinion?
Shouldn't call it Debian, or just say that it's non-official image? That's different.
Yeah, it is
Debian.
Yeah, but I think what we care about is having that is called official Debian or not. The fact that it's based on Debian, I mean, we have many derivatives and such. Like, I would put like two categories, one official Debian and the rest of.
Official.
I would have three.
Okay, but go on. What's your definition?
I didn't mean to jump the line, though.
Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, So how about adding a definition for something that's called Debian-based, and then saying hosting providers can call this a Debian-based image, or something like that? Or is that what Timmy is going to?
Yeah, but the point is to know which one we certify as Debian and made by the project, okay? The rest of, like, everybody can say it's Debian-based, and we don't have to control that.
I think Malloy was next.
We do have something which is very stable, and we call it Debian stable. If anyone of you is running SID at the moment, you'll see that we are not quite as stable as all that. So I think it is perfectly fine for people to create images which say, this is stable Debian, this is testing Debian, this is bleeding edge, unstable Debian, use at your own risk. And I do want to make a distinction again about official Debian images. I would go stronger and say official Debian images are created by Debian developers, maybe by the CD or the release team or whoever steps up to make cloud images, but it will be something delegated by the DPL. Based on Debian can be, as long as it gives you a Debian experience, I'm fine with it, even if it is made by proprietary tools.
But again, should it be just said it's official, or because based, let's say, if I just use Debian, right, and build it, it's not based on Debian, it is Debian, it's just non-official build, right, so it's not just base. No, basically, like I take the base and then build up on top, that would be.
But when we look at CD images, we have a long history of that. CD images which are labeled Debian official are not just take the base and build on top of it. We provide a set of images that can be burnt on CDs. But anybody can take net install Debian and add things onto it. There are all kinds of rescue disks out there. They're based on Debian, but they're not official Debian.
Right, but they
I don't see the cloud images being any different.
Yeah, I sort of... Yeah, I sort of view, as far as based on Debian goes, I don't view that as something that we have the right to restrict as long as it's accurate. I view it as purely descriptive. I don't view it any differently than, you know, made after having a conversation with a Debian developer, right? You know, if it's Windows 10, it's not based on Debian, that would be misleading. If it's, you take Debian and then you add a lot of proprietary Oracle junk, it's still based on Debian, it's just not Debian. If you call it official Debian and Debian is not heavily in control of the build, release, certification, testing process, if it doesn't meet any Debian's, you know, ethical standards, etc., definitely not official Debian. I view there as being a wide middle ground called Debian. So for example, if somebody takes the Debian installer source code, builds it on their personal machine, doesn't run through whatever validation the DI team does and installs it, it's Debian, but it's not official Debian installer disk. And similarly, there's a lot of ways you can modify things without changing the essential nature or the supportability to a great degree. That I would call still Debian.
I was just gonna say, I think, although we're talking about a lot about cloud images and so on here, some of the issue is no different from, if you imagine there were a lot more companies selling laptops with Debian pre-installed, there's exactly the same issues there. That so it, I don't think we can really stop someone saying this is a laptop with Debian installed, even if they added, they installed Debian and then also install Flash and random other proprietary junk. It's still, it's true to say it's a laptop with Debian
installed. Wi-Fi firmware.
Yeah, well, indeed. But I mean, I agree. On top of that, there may be some special status that we want to give people beyond that, that they say, this is somehow a blessed, approved Debian installation setup. But that's a different thing. You can't stop people saying it's Debian if it is Debian. I mean, if they're being truthful, they installed Debian on this thing, whether it's a laptop or a cloud, it is a Debian system.
Chris, I just wanted to say one thing, which is, for me, the important difference, I agree with everything that's been said, by the way, no discussion about that. Note to self and to the bear, importance, the current Amazon images are presented as if they're stable Debian, official. And that's actually wrong. So that text has to be fixed.
Yeah.
Somebody owns that and somebody needs to fix it.
And so with regard to the Google images, I no longer work at Google, but I did when this conversation happened. Google consulted on the Debian Cloud list with regard to whether to call it Debian or and I don't believe there was an official consultation with the trademark's alias, because I think at that time that was operating in a more dormant and less formalized way than it is now. But I believe Brian did speak up as somebody who was involved in both categories, and the DPL at the time and the prior DPL, so Zach and Luca were in the conversation as well. People were fine with calling it Debian, but not official Debian, because the deviations were justified, small, documented, and there was a desire to fix them, and everything with free software.
But my point was just that needs to be fixed for the Amazon.
Right. No, I'm just making a comparison.
My point was that important difference for me is the dog reporting.
Yeah.
So anything that's a Debian derivative, we had this discussion with Ubuntu.
Right.
All bug reports sent from that system should first go to them.
Yeah.
Right. So if Google has an image, all bug reports sent from any user of that system should first go to Google. Then they can talk with Debian about it if it's...
They don't currently make that change, but they will support it if their support contract people call
and
them.
And that's, I think we should state that somewhere. That, you know, if you're not really Debian, we really ask you kindly, please, if you want to be a good citizen, you should take all third bug reports through
but
you.
Do
first.
We enable it easily that way?
Not
do we want to force them all to patch report bug to say, don't use it? Because that kind of puts additional barrier, don't do derivatives, because you have to
and
do
and we need to change our documentation, then not always.
It's difficult to enforce it, and it's difficult to detect it.
Yeah.
No, but it's also really annoying that we get all the bug reports that we can't reproduce, because we don't have the system.
Do we
you cannot reproduce it, it's another matter.
That's not the normal case, even from that situation.
Could we refer to the conversation about what we call the Debian official? Because I think that's what counts here. No?
Wait, I think we'll get to that. I just want to try and maintain the order somewhat. One of you two.
What about a unified script for building those cloud images? Like, we already have that called Bootstrap Reset, and have some sort of test suite we can test those images,
mm-hmm.
some sort of, I don't know, Jenkins or whatever test suite, so we can see those images comply to at least a certain amount of tests that the Debian project decides to be the official tests for those cloud images. Because that would give the project also a chance to call them official.
So, I think everyone sort of agreed that official Debian is something produced by the project, published on Debian.org, CD image, etc. It's something we produce. There's then the description of based on Debian. It's descriptive. It's obvious that something's based on Debian. Ubuntu is based on Debian, but we wouldn't really want it called Debian because it's not. But there is somewhere in between it, which is essentially sort of a scratch and sniff test. So you sort of hold it up and you put it up to the light and go, is this Debian? You go, yeah, it's obviously Debian. So if someone takes Debian and for whatever reason they need a newer kernel or they need to backport something, it's pretty obvious that it is Debian, but it's being produced by someone else and it's had a slight flavor or a twist to it. And this is not theoretical. There's large organizations out there who have produced Debian derivatives and given it its own name because they don't want to fall foul of our trademark usage. But they want to call it Debian because that's basically what it is. So there's no point in deploying this large distribution over here. And they said, it's just Debian. They want to give us the credit of saying it's that. So a possibility around saying, like, it's Debian from Oracle, for example. I mean, terrible example, but if it's, it is basically there, you get the idea. So so there is clarity that it's Debian, but it's not produced by us, so it's not something that we, in the first instance, come across. So a way of being able to say, yes, you can use the Debian mark, if we have the clarity that these things are in place, so you could say, please make sure you document somehow the changes you've made or something like that. But people should be able to use the Debian mark when it's, I mean, to be honest, Debian's used a lot more widely than people recognize, partially because we don't, we're a little scared of allowing things to be called Debian in that way.
Are you on your name?
So I just wanted to make a point. So it is in Debian's interest that derivatives are called out as a product of the community release, because ultimately what happens is, as the market becomes more aware of Debian, more support gets given to Debian. Right now there's a situation where there's a lot of people who are producing derivatives calling them something different. That value is accruing to whatever they're calling that thing, right? Debian for Oracle is called, let's say, Oracle Linux, right? The value accrues to Oracle Linux. It doesn't accrue to Debian, right? Even though the work came from Debian. So it's in the community's interest that derivatives are associated with Debian, because that way the community becomes aware, the broader community, not the developer community, but the broader community, the user community, the market, becomes aware of where the work actually came from. So then they value those people who do that work. I agree with everything that was said before. I think there are stratifications, right? You know, certainly official Debian should come from Debian. Certainly based on Debian, components of Debian, artifacts of Debian, I don't know what the stratifications are, right? But there are clearly stratifications. Where you draw the lines, probably around what the notion of non-proprietary release, contrib-based release, only free software-based release. You know, there's probably a line that can be drawn there. There's probably a line that can be drawn in testing as well. I really like the idea of having automated tests around the release to classify which part of the strata you get thrown into. But, you know, wholesale saying, no, Debian is a trademark, needs to only be associated with official Debian releases, causes a problem where people don't realize that people are essentially taking advantage of the community's effort and then accruing value to that thing outside of it, like Ubuntu. Right? A tremendous amount of value is accrued to Ubuntu that doesn't come from Ubuntu. It comes from Debian. So.
I pretty much agree with everything both you just said, and for the most part with everyone said. There is tremendous value in exposing the name of Debian more. I think there's maybe 3 or 4 tiers of Debian-ishness. There's official, that's obvious, and there's derivatives, or based on, or call it a dot, for example, Ubuntu, or Mint, or doesn't matter. In between, I think we've got 1 or 2 areas. One where people are basically trying to stay as close as humanly possible to what the original Debian is, but they just have to make some decision. They say they may need a backport for a kernel, or they may need a driver, or maybe they need to install some firmware. It doesn't matter, but where they really, really try to stay as close to vanilla Debian as possible, and this should be something which should be honored, but also verified. And then on the other hand, you have someone who basically just tosses Debian onto a laptop, installs Flash or what have you, and basically is not a wholly derivative like Ubuntu, but still it's quite far from what a vanilla Debian might be. So maybe we have even 4 different tiers, so to speak.
Yes, I want to say, if you make rule, you have to think about two things. The first is how to control that rule, and as easier it is, it's better. And the second thing is, what should be done if a person or a company is uncompliant with that rule? Yes. If you so, maybe you find some perfect rules for you, but you can't control them. They are worthless.
Well, I guess the ultimate sanction there is Debian withdraws its trademark grant. Issues a press release.
We do have the force of law if we need it.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, if we certify things, we can have a certified Debian page which again, you can't call yourself certified unless you're on that page, which we control.
I think Brian has been waiting for a while, right?
Yes, but you raised your hand. Oh, yeah, Valencia.
Okay. One thing that I might have been wanting to say is that with regard to testing, we shouldn't focus too much on the specifics of that during the session, except insofar if we want to make it a criteria for the name. I think most of the things that are built as Debian, except for the official CD releases, maybe it's slightly DI and actually the Google images, mostly don't currently, nothing except for those currently has a good test suite. More sharing of test suites and automation should happen, including from Google, right? But that's mostly a separate discussion, except for whether we want it as a criterion. Yeah.
Okay, so I just wanted to speak about this from the trademark. There's a couple ways to go about what we're doing, but we're kind of limited to one way right now. There's certification marks, and there's trademarks, and we have a trademark. Certification mark is kind of like what we want. We want to set a set of criteria that this is a product that meets this thing. But the different, why we can't use certification mark is the person who owns the certification mark can't produce a product that's tested by that certification mark. So, like, you might have, like, this is tequila or something, and it's certified tequila or certified champagne, but the organization that owns that mark can't make champagne or tequila.
So like SPI for us could certify.
No, SPI owns the trademark.
SPI owns the trademark, yeah.
Oh, but the mark could be different.
It could be a different mark.
Yeah.
You know, like we could come up with a new mark.
It doesn't have to be a certification mark, though. It could just be a page saying Debian endorses this, and then it's just like unfair representation if you're not.
Why I'm mentioning certification mark is that it sounds like that's what we want to create, but we really can't because we want to produce the product as well. So one of the risks I'm hearing about letting anybody go off and make Debian is if we don't tightly control the quality of the product that our licensees produce, we risk the mark becoming, losing the mark and losing the ability to stop people from using the mark when we don't want them to. We're not really risking the ability to someone stopping us from losing the mark, but we're risking the ability to stop people who are doing something we really hate from using that mark. So I just want to make that clear. Like, when we talk about official Debian, like in the ideal world from trademark law, when you say official Debian, that should be the only Debian. But I know that's not the reality we live in, so we have to just be careful. I'm saying about letting people use it without adequate, oversight.
I don't know if I'm next
to about endorsing those who are staying very close to Debian, only tweaking small pieces like a driver or something like that. We already have a name for that, and please don't invent new names. It will just pollute, confuse, and even more. It's called the Debian brand, Debian blend. So
that means something different.
No, it means exactly being very close to Debian. If you are within Debian, it's a Debian pure blend. Yeah. I invented the word, so I pretty much know what I'm talking about.
No company's going to want to use that marketing.
Okay, yeah. Fine. So you want to have computers.
That's also the value of certification, because that's something which companies really want to have, just a stamp, you are the guy.
I think it was you, Demurray, or was it the other way around? No, I think it was you, then Murray, and then so, but I'm not quite sure.
So if you did, and I'm not an expert on trademark law by any stretch of the imagination, so, but I have been exposed to it a little bit. If you did a powered by Debian, would that
would be perfectly okay.
So I think that, I can't speak to all of the individuals concerned about this, right, but I think that getting sufficiently close to just having a relationship with Debian, right, to show value from where the value actually came from, using a powered by Debian would be sufficient for a derivative release that that may have a smaller package count or may have, you know, specialized drivers, you know, maybe even some components that are proprietary.
But it would be, to be clear, it would be a licensing agreement to
yeah.
use our trademark.
No, no, no.
And
I
we
totally
would have to file
that.
For the trademark, a new trademark, powered by Debian.
Yes, I totally agree
That's
with that. And
not in the U.S. You could do that with the existing trademark in the U.S.
Okay.
I don't know about other countries, though.
Okay.
And I would even go as far as to say that, you know, automated testing, you know, some certification test, right, would be a step that you would want to go through to make sure that the system was compliant in some way. I don't know the frequency of test, the extent of changes required to retest.
Yeah, I mean, ideally there would be the testing component, but yeah.
I was just going to say, I think it's kind of too, seems too ambitious at this stage to say we're going to come up with a policy that can be implemented in a fully direct, like automated level way. At the moment, there's going to be something where there's human involvement in approvals in an ongoing way. So that the advantage of that is it means we don't need to worry too much about every possible corner case. I think the cases where this is going to be easiest is actually working with other large organizations, whether that's HP, for example. Where this is not their business. The case is actually a lot more complex, as if you have someone who wants to make a fork of Debian, for example, I don't know, someone that wants to change Debian to use Upstart and delete all other init systems. I mean, it's still true, it's based on Debian, we might even want them to be advertising that, but we might have more sensitivity about them labeling it as improved Debian or something. I mean, it's a more tricky thing. We actually had this issue, well, a similar issue with, also even a long time ago, the Debian Core Consortium was an attempt to use the Debian name in a way we weren't altogether happy with. But I think, again, if we accept that it is case by case, and whatever agreement we need, we're going to need some ways to pull back from that. So, for example, even with someone like HP, if HP decided tomorrow, actually they're going to make it fully required to install this thing to have tons of proprietary drivers and extra tools there, maybe we stop being happy with them calling it Debian. But I think we can easily have some kind of agreements that would do this. I don't think it's, I think it's going too far into the future or possibly something we would never want to have, to imagine we're going to have a full set of rules that has every single case and we just go through and tick boxes.
So, if we imagine a world where reproducible builds have all been done and everything's magic, so what I do is I download all the source from Debian website, I rebuild it on my own infrastructure, so not using WannaBuild, still use ZestBuild or something like that, produce it, package it up, install it somewhere, then it is Debian, but it's not being produced by Debian, if you see what I mean. So it's still obviously Debian. So it's working out how we can use that to and enable some of these large companies who are producing derived distributions, but it's not really derived. It's just they don't have permission to use our marks, and they want to use the marks. So some large organizations they say we don't want to call it this. We want to call it Debian, because that's what it is. We've changed the kernel, we've updated that, we've backported this graphics package or something over here, but that's it. And trying to keep that close and how we can...
So that's not official Debian then?
It's not official Debian, because we haven't produced it.
And then how about the Amazon image, which is a non-modified Debian just built on Amazon infrastructure, which to me makes it non-free. What's your point about
well,
view on that?
It's not official Debian.
And it's also not unmodified. It adds a couple of things that they have, the AWS CLI interface, which is a proprietary package inside.
Okay.
So, you know, it really, somebody should look at that web page and just, you know, tell whoever is responsible to clean it up. Because it's really bad now.
So With regard to what Murray said, yeah, I agree it needs to have human involvement, and I really think even if it is automated, like, so I think in order to use, like, certainly anything that's the unmodified trademark or close to it, I certainly think that humans should be involved in oversight, or the right of oversight, the right to oversee, even if it is automated, just because, you know, our opinion can also change as long as we give some reasonable notice to be fair to them. And I think, as for, like, powered by Debian, I mean, unless we spent a lot of effort making that an appealing mark, I think it won't achieve some of the reasons companies want to call it Debian. So from the company perspective, the reasons they want to call it Debian are, among those reasons would be their customers are requesting Debian, and so something that's Debian-ish might not, like, what's the ish part, right? You know, powered by Debian. If, let's say, a vendor supports Debian as an operating system, if it's close enough to Debian that whatever the vendor is doing is probably going to work, you know, they want, like, let's say, imagine, to use our favorite example of the session, Oracle, we're supporting OracleDB on Debian, you know, it, just the fact that it's running in, I don't know, the great public cloud of China, for example, would not change that fact, aside from firewall issues. But so if the things that companies or their customers or relationships care about the Debian mark, you know, would not be satisfied by an altered label, we want them to be able to call it Debian maybe, but not official Debian, as long as we are involved enough to make sure they're not doing anything nasty and can say no if they change their nastiness.
Walter, did you raise your hand earlier?
I did, but it's been covered, so.
Dan, do you want to? Because if not, then I think...
I just want to mention the Amazon CLI is Apache 2 license, and there are three implementations of the Amazon API, so it's not proprietary package. I don't know what definition, but I've seen proprietary is not.
So there is many voices for making it available, but then somehow regulating it. Not a single company would decide to use Debian as part of their product if later on we could just pull that carpet off their feet, right?
They would.
I don't know. Let's say I, as little company, I don't want to go and establish my business for some name which later on could be taken away from me. Just
companies do it all the time.
Yeah, that happens all the time.
I think the issue is that they don't want the conditions for use to change. Mm-hmm. So as long as the conditions for use are known at the time that they agree to base their product on it, then that's cool, right? That's a condition of use. That's they're getting some value, quite a lot. Actually.
But is it feasible to establish those conditions in reasonable time, and so they're human comprehensible by a regular mortal, not by some lawyer? Because we're talking about small projects some regular developers decided to pull off, right? If they go and there is like, oh, you need to satisfy those 20 regimens, it's like, I'll screw it, I'll just call it whatever, right? Because that's easier. There is this kind of entry point which makes it difficult if there is too much of bureaucracy and lawyers involved. And kind of, would it be, that's my concern only, to not lose Debian trademark, right? But let's say if we could say that you could use Debian as part of your product name as long as you state that this is not an official Debian product. Not an official product of Debian project. That's it. So they could use it, then it's clear that it's not official, period, right? There is no like fear, okay, later on somebody will come and that's it. I need to rename it.
For our users, we do want them to get the Debian experience. I'm sure we will take Windows 10 and say this is not a product of the Debian project, but it's Debian.
But see, there is, of course, range where people could go insane, mm-hmm. right? Yes. Does it happen? I don't know. I didn't see any such case.
So, it's interesting to note that the CDT produce unofficial Debian images, right?
What's the CDT?
Debian CD.
Sorry.
Yeah, so... if you take Debian, official Debian, and enable contrib repo, that is no longer official Debian.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right, so we have something ourselves that if you have contrib and if you have non-free in your sources.
I can make that even worse. I'm running Debian unstable on my laptop. Now, I'm explicitly installing a package which FTP master a week later decides to remove for whatever reason. Is that laptop still running Debian? It was in the archive when I installed the laptop, it's not in the archive anymore. So is that still Debian or is it not?
It's unofficial Debian.
It's powered by Debian.
Powered by Debian and Debian?
And when I've been talking to some organisations there, I mean, some of the rules that we can put in place are fairly straightforward and very happy. So it's thing we could do something along the lines of for it to be called Debian, it needs to have only free software, well, DFSG free software. You could do things like you need to maintain a list of changes or where it's diverged from what official Debian is. We can review it once a quarter or once a year.
Everybody loves to maintain them and change logs, and here are my changes? Nah.
No, it's literally come from a company who says, we're doing this because we think it's a good idea. So would you like that? Would that be a way we could carry on looking at? And you can review it, and I'm very happy to do that. And and we can put things in line, around trying to feed things back in or keeping nimble changes as well. So that's not necessarily a problem from a lot of the organizations I've talked to.
But in fact, people are legally required to do that already, because the social contract says that they must, if you ask them, give you that source code.
Oh, no, but this source code is different from like documenting the changes. That's completely different.
Well,
by GPL, we need to also list in every file. Right? Yeah. Do we do that?
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Well, not always.
So
then you better fix those packages, file logs.
So
try to figure it out.
We do. We have good tools for that.
So if Debian would produce those images on CD image, Debian org, or wherever infrastructure, and the cloud providers are then downloading that exact image, which has the exact same checksum into their repository for publishing that to their end users. That's called official Debian?
Could be if a release team does it.
Yeah, okay, so and this is what's happening on HP Cloud, because I wrote that OpenStack package OpenStack Debian images that is now integrated in the CD process release. So on every pub release, we have a new pub release for that.
But that's a script
image
for one exact cloud infrastructure.
Anyone that, you, that
we have a bootstrap reset for doing several cloud infrastructures. So having one script for all of the.
That OpenStack Debian images script is used only for the OpenStack image, but if you were running it on Amazon, now that they do support mostly HVM, I think it would work as well, but it wouldn't include the CLI. Okay, so one thing I wanted to talk about as well, like before JC was released, I was doing these images. They were not produced by the CD team because Steve wanted to have it only for Jesse, so it was testing at the time. And then for Wheezy, I was adding three backports, so CloudInit, RAMFS tools, and whatever. And then the question is, because I'm activating backports, is this really the Debian stable image?
No.
No. Probably not.
Probably not. Okay.
At the same time, people who are running stable,
that's the software that is installed is from the Debian archive.
Yeah, so that is fully Debian archive from backports and whatever. So it's fully official, but probably not Debian stable. And now the JC image is obviously fully stable.
So perhaps the way we deal with the way we officially deal with it on hash Debian IRC channel is, have you installed from Debian Media just using free and no backports, and you don't have any other random sources in there or something else? And that is something that hash Debian will support. If we get users coming along, we'll try and fix their problems. There's then, oh, you've installed Mint. It's like, please go talk to Mint. Or no, we don't support Ubuntu here because they changed it all, and there's just no way we can do that. But there's something in between that we do try and support as well. So if you have installed backports, or even if you have installed a third-party repository, we'll normally say, go talk to them. But if you installed, say, some, well, traditional ones of the multimedia codec days, they install that, but they're having problems with Emacs. Then it's sort of like, yeah, it's still going to be, oh, I don't know, unless Emacs does video playing these days. Not non-linear video editing in Emacs. So there is this grey area in between that. It is a bit of a judgment call looking at it and going, yeah, it's Debian. We know it's Debian.
And it's not official.
No, it's not. But we know it is because you look at it and it's obviously, it's possibly, as Manoj said, using the Debian experience or something like that. We know what it is. You know it when you see it. Trying to codify that is tricky. And trying to put something in law or in some guidelines and saying, we know it when we see it. Probably, I think a lawyer would describe it as inadvisable.
Well, it worked in the US.
Yes. So,
if you're going the non-free infrastructure stuff, then you have to disregard your almost all hardware anyway, because it's non-free, the hardware. Okay. And if it's software on the hardware, it doesn't really change.
But we're not certifying hardware.
No.
Neither do we certify infrastructure.
So we don't certify hardware. We
do we certify infrastructure? I don't think we
not
do.
Not right now.
No.
Our lovely folks at the Free Software Foundation can help certify hardware.
Yeah.
So,
but then there would be, that's another interesting topic that maybe we should do. Okay, like about having a certified logo, or Debian on, I don't know, makers like Supermicro and things like that.
I do want to both agree and disagree with Toma. Different things you said. with regard to whether
1 minute side, so we should keep short.
Okay. All right. So we do. I think we definitely want it to be possible, if they're calling it even not official but just Debian without a lot of descriptors. It should be possible, yes, for anybody, whether they're employed by the company or not, to use personal hardware, not the company's services, to do the build if they want to. Whether they can use the company's hardware, it doesn't matter. And but it needs to be possible otherwise, with public instructions. And also, as far as the backport issue, I agree with Neil that sometimes it's reasonable to call it still Debian stable if certain backports are in, not if it's like heavily backported, but like, for example, the common case of needing a new kernel for like hardware driver support, like let's say it's the backports kernel, not a custom proprietary modification thing. You know, a lot of people would, talking to their friends, very legitimately say, I'm running Jesse. Oh yeah, I happened to grab the newer kernel to make my laptop run well, but it's still Jesse. So it depends, it's a scratch and sniff test, yeah.
Yes, I came in late, but I think no one has mentioned ISVs yet. And I think it's actually such a good comparison because we are on the other side. So Firefox is such a strong brand, and we are shipping, it's Firefox, but obviously we have the packaging, right? And I think that we had to rename it, actually hurt both of the projects, because for us, it's a lot of confusion, you know, what is Ice Weasel? And I think for Firefox, it also doesn't help them, because the, you know, Debian is also a big distro, and if they can say, oh, you know, Firefox is the default in Debian, I think that also helps them. Mm-hmm. And so I definitely see the need, again, with Debian, we have a strong brand, so we need to protect it. You know, not everything can be called Debian, but I think we need to be, like, open that, obviously, yeah, they need to patch it, like, they probably going to change the